So, good afternoon. Let's recall what we were doing. We were discussing renormalization of circle diffeomorphisms. And there is this little picture. We have renormalization. And we showed already that renormalization allows you to give a description of the topology of our circle diffeomorphisms. It also allowed us to construct the measure theory, to construct invariant measures. And it also allowed us to say something about topological classes and the bifurcation pattern. So what is left, and we will do that today, is geometry. And so today we will finish the circle diffeomorphisms, and then the rest of the week we will lead to the geometry of Hannon maps. But let's see what we mean by geometry. Let's think about we have a certain circle diffeomorphism, and what do we mean by the geometry of such a diffeomorphism? There are many geometrical questions you can ask. And for example, an example geometrical question would be, let's take a point, and let's iterate it, and at some point, the return, let's call this point zero. At some point, we return at the closest you can get, and then a little later, you return even a little closer, and then even later, you return even closer, et cetera. And you could ask yourself, what is the convergence of this convergence? How fast, what is the rate of, is there a rate of convergence of this returning point? And that would be a geometrical question. And there are many others you can ask, but for example, to get some idea. So there is a theorem which solves any geometrical question you can think about. And that is a theorem by Hermann. Let's see what we get. So we have, let's say a C3 circle diffeo. And let's say the rotation number of F is given by the continued fractions of F. Now, let's see what else. And let's say, so we know that we have a homeoconjugating F with the rigid rotation. We have such a conjugation. And so our homeomorphism, this is a homeo. And so this homeomorphism tells us everything about the topology we want to know. But now Michel Hermann proved that actually if the AN does not go to infinity too fast, then H is C1 plus alpha diffeo. And so that means that H is differentiable. and actually 8, and its inverse is differentiable. And the derivative of this homeomorphism is alpha Hölder. And that means you have some control of how the derivative changes. Let me recall what that means. It's a sort of Lipschitz condition. For the alpha. And so, and now suppose that you have a C3 diffeomorphism, and the ans do not go too fast to infinity, then our h is a C1 diffeomorphism, and that means that on a very small scale, this conjugating map is affine. And so that means that on small scale, a small scale geometry of F is the same as small scale geometry of the rigid rotation. And so if you want to answer what you see here on very small scale, you just look at the corresponding picture for the rigid rotation. And so what we see is that the small scale geometry of a diffeomorphism is the same as the small scale geometry of the corresponding rigid rotation under a condition. The A should not go too fast to infinity. So this goes under the name of rigidity. A small scale geometry cannot be deformed. And you might say, okay, let's take our diffeomorphism and we see this orbit going around. And maybe by shifting the diffeomorphism a little bit, I can perturb how this orbit is accumulating. Now, apparently, that's impossible. And so small-scale orbit geometry is rigid under this condition. Okay. Okay, so let's do the proof. let's do the proof. Let's do the proof in the simplest case. Okay, so let's say the proof of rigidity, the Hermann theorem, or rigidity, in the simplest case. And what is the simplest case? That is when all the A's are 1, A U, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. Okay, so let's see how we do this. Now remember, in this case, a renormalization has hyperbolic behavior. Associated with this rho is 1 over 1 plus 1 over 1 plus, etc. like this. And remember what was happening again. We had one rigid rotation, and that was renormalized to another rigid rotation. And here we had the family of rigid rotations. It was an expanding curve, and the same curve will pass by to the other guy. And moreover, this is the expanding part, there is also a stable manifold in both pictures. And so, and now our map we are going to look at is sitting somewhere here. And remember that from renormalization we learned that the topological classes are stable manifolds. And so we know that our map is lying in the stable manifold. So what we get from that are two things, that the renormalization of F converges to these two points. It will converge paths and then come back. And this convergence will be exponentially fast. So let's make a picture. And so we know, of the nth renormalization. And that is some diffeomorphism. Let's make a picture, so something like this. And somewhere is the critical point, which of course depends on where you are in the renormalization. And somewhere is a Vn. And somewhere here is the diagonal. And somewhere here, so it converts to the rigid rotations. And for the rigid rotations, this is a straight line. Let me first make the nth renormalization of this one. And it will also look something like that. And now there will be a C. And there will be a V. And that will be exactly a straight line here and exactly a straight line here. And this C number and this V number are fixed. And so and now our nth renormalization looks very much like one of this one. But it means that this branch here is almost a straight line. There's a little twiggle in it, but not a lot. And the other side also, it's almost a straight line. So you see that the distance between these pictures is lambda to the n. It's something exponentially small. Let me be a bit more precise about it. And so what we mean is that here we have our Vn, and here we have our Vn star, V star. So the pictures are exponentially close, but that means that in particular, Cn and this perfect number are exponentially small. And so this is 0, 1, this is 0, 1. And these points, they're almost at the same place. And the same for the Vn's. The Vn are exponentially close to what it is supposed to be, giving the rigid rotation. Okay. There's one other piece of information. Remember, we were looking at renormalizations, but there was another tool, and that were the towers. So let's make the tower. Let's make the tower of F. So we do the same thing. Here we have Ln, here we have Rn, and then we have our tower. And here we have the nth renormalization of F rho, And that also has a tower, and there is an LN here, and there is an RN here, and there is some tower here. And there is a tower here. Now, of course, in this tower, we know that if you take the bottom and you go to a certain level I, then this map is affine. And that is, it's a rigid rotation, so all iterates are something affine. So if you go from the bottom to any level, you get an affine map. So from this exponential convergence, from looking in the proof of this, we know that in this case, this map is exponentially close to affine. And so that means that the towers, they also look the same. Not only the position of these two points and the two branches, the picture of the renormalization, but the towers are also exponentially close. Okay, so now let's renormalize. And what was renormalization again? You have to take, this is going to be important, so let me use red. And so what you have to do is, to renormalize, you have to cut one of the buildings, and the cutting point is like Vn, or a Vn star. Okay, so let's put here V star, and then you will see that the cutting will happen exactly at relatively the same position. If this had a distance 0.4 of the whole thing, then this also would be 0.4 of the whole thing, and because this map is affine. So now let's take our V1, Vn, and we have to cut also here, so we have to take Vn here, and we have to cut somewhere here. So, but now let's look what we get from this and this information, and the fact that these iterates from the bottom to a level are almost affine. So let's take this interval, and let's zoom it out to a unit interval. And so somewhere here we will find V star up to scaling. We get to the same size. And the proportion of this to that is the same as the proportion of this to that. And let's do the same thing here. Let's take this interval and let's zoom it also to unit size. And then the cutting point will be sitting somewhere here, Vn. And this distance will be exponentially close. So the place where you're going to cut in the tower of F to construct the new renormalization is exponentially close to the cutting place of the construction of the next renormalization of the rigid rotation. Okay, so this is about the towers, but there is a circle. So let's use the towers to go back to the circle and look how the conjugation goes. And remember how we built the conjugation. Let me make a picture and you will remember. And so all these intervals here, and those, they are actually lying in the circle. And they form this, what we called the dynamical partition. here we also had the corresponding dynamical partition of the rigid rotation. And the conjugation has to be something like that. But whatever the conjugation does, it has to take corresponding pieces to corresponding pieces. So in particular, this level has to go to that level. But that, this picture, that as if you take this level, this has to go to the corresponding level there. So all layers are preserved. And then we use that to approximate the conjugation, remember. So let's see how that goes. Here is going to be a graph. This is going to be the graph of our conjugation, the approximations. So let's take this little interval. And I don't know where it is in the circle, but let's say it's somewhere here. Somewhere in the circle. And let's take its friend, the corresponding interval of the rigid rotation. And we know that the conjugation has to glue them together. So maybe here is the interval of the rigid rotation. And now we know that our conjugation is something inside here. There's also stuff here, but we don't worry about it for the moment. But remember that we constructed this sequence, Hn, converging to our conjugation. And Hn, by construction, was made in such a way that it is just a straight line on this level. Okay, so now let's make a picture of Hn plus 1. Now that you have to do by taking the cutting point here. And this is exactly this cutting point. And you have to take the corresponding cutting point of you have to take the corresponding cutting point in the interval of the rigid rotation, and those have to be matched together. And so these have to be matched together, and the rest is affine. And so this is Hn plus 1, and this is Hn. And so, and now you're almost done. And because these points, they are nicely in the middle. They're 0.4 or something, 0.6. And now you know that relatively, they are exponentially close. And so that means that the distance here is exponentially close. But because they are sort of sitting in the middle, these slopes, these two slopes, are also exponentially close to the slope you had before. You see that? So here you use that these points are exponentially close. We are using this piece of information, and we use that this guy is nicely sitting somewhere in the middle. It's not crazily in the border. It's sort of nicely in the middle. And so then you really see this picture, that the next approximation has a slope which is exponentially close to the slope of Hn. And so let me write down what we got. Maybe first we see that hn plus 1 and hn in just in distance is exponentially close. But we also see that the derivatives are exponentially close. Of course, you have to be a bit careful because in the corners, they are not differentiable. And so this means where the affine pieces, they have exponentially close slopes. Okay? And now, and from this exercise for tomorrow, it is really not difficult. But to do it right, you have to deal with techniques here. Exercise for tomorrow, that dhn converges to dh, which is continuous. That's the exercise. If you take the limit, of course, you can see that this is not going to be a big deal. And you see almost uniform convergence of the derivatives. And so you will have a candidate function, which is going to be the derivative. And then you have to show that dh is dh, in the sense that you get a limiting function, and the second part of the exercise is to show that this limiting function is, in fact, the derivative. It's all little things. But like, don't forget, we are doing dynamics, and we are dealing with the analysis of dynamics. And here you see, it's not going to be difficult, but there is some analysis involved. And the third part is showing that this derivative is Hölder. Now, and that is also not very difficult, because what you know is these intervals, they shrink down exponentially fast. You have to believe me. You can see this from the picture. And the mesh of Pn goes to zero exponentially fast. Maybe not with the same lambda, but with some Rn, which has something to do with the cutting place. But then you see that the fluctuations on the scale of dh on the scale ii is lambda to the n. And so you see an exponential a fluctuation of order lambda to the n on a scale of r to the n. And so what we need is that lambda to the n is proportional to some rn to the alpha. And like the fluctuations should be bounded by the distance to a certain exponent. And then you raise the n and you get an alpha. And so like the little technical part, but you will have fun doing it. It is sort of nice. You can finish the rigidity theorem. Okay. So let's go to the bad news. Remember, so the theorem of Hermann, it says that if an goes is not too fast to infinity, then rigidity h is c1 plus alpha. And now there's a counterexample. Maybe not a counterexample, but there's an example is made by Arnold. And that says the following. There exists an analytic. Analytic circle diffeo. Which is infinitely renormalizable. And the invariant measure, I remember that we were able to use our renormalization and the loops, you remember, to construct an invariant measure. And moreover, we proved in the circle case there is a unique invariant measure. So this is this invariant measure of our circle diffeomorphism, and that one is singular with respect to Lebesgue measure. So it's a measure concentrated on a set of measure zero. Yeah. It has something to do with being, not necessarily.
So
why
did you use the AM not so fast?
Now what can happen is that you see you have to make a little correction here. And if we have, so this was a plus renormalization. Eh? You see we are cutting on the plus side. So suppose that we have to do plus renormalization for a long, 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 long time. So that means that the next time there will be a cut here. And there will be a cut here. And these proportions will be sort of the same. But then you have to start to make this thing here. And then there is each time a little error. But if the number of times you have to repeat this procedure is much larger than the errors you have, the thing can blow up.
So the AN has to do with how often we have to.
Yeah, so AN is exactly the number of cuts, of right cuts. And so if you have many cuts to do here, then there are exponential small errors, but you have to do tons of cuts, and that can screw up the thing. And what will happen is that if you have to do many cuts here, then eventually this guy will be sitting almost in the corner, your suggestion. But then on this side, there could have been many little errors, and it could be that point is still way behind. And then you see that the conjugation has to take this little piece and has to put it in something really big. And that means that the derivative is going to be enormous. And so it has something to do with accumulation of errors.
Where is the information about how many times you cut the graph?
Now, in our case, we had AN is 1. And so we know that the cutting point is like the Fibonacci number. We know exactly where it is. If AN gets large, then this guy gets close in the corner here, and then it jumps uniformly through here. But then on the other side, it starts to jump around, but it starts to accumulate errors, and then the thing is screwed up. And in the example I'm going to show you, it's really going to happen. But you have to take the ANs very large.
This example is supposed to be an example where AN is not sufficient. It's too fast.
It's going to be ridiculous to infinite. It's like you cannot imagine how fast it goes.
Because this singularity is a counter.
You know what is going to happen is? So I make this picture here. And your orbit is just coming through. And these are the consecutive plus cuts. These are the plus cuts. And this is sort of, and this is not sort of, this is a uniform cut. So each little piece has the same length. That is for the rigid rotation. So in this example, what is going to happen is that the cuts you are going to see here are like this. So it starts out nice. And here there are like really a billion guys. And then slowly it gets, then suddenly it gets out again. And so, and of course, if you take your conjugation, these glues, these pieces to that pieces, it will be very tiny pieces compared to those, which have an enormous derivative. And the thing blows up. And this can happen if you get by accumulation of errors. So there is a very precise condition. There's a very sharp, it's like the Bruno thing. It's a very precise condition. If you're, yeah. So this comes from this formula, where lambda is the rate of conversions, a rate of renormalization conversions, and this R is geometrical decay. And this is how fast the renormalization converges, and this is how fast those intervals are shrinking down. And the alpha comes in exactly in this equation. So the Hölder exponent has a very precise meaning. Okay. So do we still have time, or what time do we?
Yes,
5 o'clock. Okay. So let's discuss this example. The idea for the example is this picture. Somehow you have to do something like this. Now first, remember that, let's see what happens. So take your analytic F and look at the family. And it is the one we had in our first exercise. You just rotate a little more. And then the construction is by induction, of course, by renormalization level to renormalization level. So each renormalization level, you're going to adjust how much you shift a little bit. And so let's say we are on the nth renormalization level. And we see a picture like that. Something nice here, and maybe something nice like here. This is the picture of the nth renormalization. And now comes the first adjustment. And so let's say that this is Ftn. So now comes the first adjustment in this parameter. And the first adjustment is just to push it up until you create a tendency. So the first adjustment. It's going to be something like this. Something like this. Here we still have our thing. And now it is something like, and we created a fixed point. And of course, we had an analytic map So there is only a finite number of those periodic points.
So you say that you're locked down in the family and your perturbations are within that family.
Yeah, you just rotate it. No, it is. Yeah, but the key to the exercise was monotonicity. So if you increase t, then this graph will start to move up, with at least t. That is a sort of a monotone. Now, it's not obvious, but. It is topology. You can do this by purely topology. So it's relatively easy. No, because here we use that the guy is analytic. So a guy which cannot, an analytic map cannot have an interval fixed point. And so this is the only moment where we use that the guy is analytic. Okay? So that is the first adjustment. So now look, like this is a periodic point. And let's draw the whole orbit in the circle. And so this is the whole circle. And now we just have a diffeomorphism with a periodic orbit. And you see that on the left side it will be expanding. It will drift away, but on the right side, you are coming in. And every point will be coming in eventually. And like, of course, if you take a point on the right side, very close, on the left side, it will take a long time to enter from the other side. But eventually, that will happen. So you can take an enormous iterate, and so take Tn enormous, such that almost every point lies in this very tiny, let's say this is of the size 1/1, like very tiny, and the whole thing here is very tiny. The total length is smaller than like 1/n. But after this number of iterates, almost every point landed up somewhere on the right side. And so after that number of times, you see that 99% of the points, after this number of iterates, ended up in this very tiny little neighborhood. And so that means that if you think in terms of measures, and the measure is supposed to describe how the orbit is distributed, so you see at this moment that it is essentially the discrete measure concentrated on the periodic points, which describes the distribution. So it's extremely singular. It's sitting essentially in a finite set of points. And more singular than that, you cannot get it. So, and then the second adjustment, you know what to do. Now remember, this is the picture of the nth renormalization. And you remember that this graph is like a certain iterate of the original map. And so if you go back to the picture of the original circle, you will see Rn points. Okay? So it is really a periodic orbit. And almost every point after 1 million steps is unbelievably close to this periodic orbit. It looks singular. Now you know this was the first adjustment. Now let's make the second adjustment. And you know what to do. So second adjustment And so let's go back here. We have our map, and something like this, and something like that. And now let's make an adjustment. And this adjustment is really unbelievably fine. And what you do is, you do this. You know what you do. And this is sort of the same. And now you do this. So it's the same picture. Except that you erased the periodic point. But if you do, so what is really happening here, if you zoom out a little bit, so if you zoom out this picture, and what you really see there is the diagonal comes through, and your graph is something like that. And but then you see, so the periodic point is gone, and now what happens is that your points are coming in, and but this is so small, it's going to take forever, essentially, an steps to come through this little tunnel. And so you will see in that picture that you still have almost every orbit concentrate along this periodic orbit if you look at this time. And now you repeat. And on the next scale, you make this even smaller. And so you get, if you go on, then you will see smaller and smaller sets in measure, which carry 99.99999%, the next time even more. And in the limit, you will get a singular measure.
I guess the measure is still
supported on the circle. Yeah, it's a dense set, because it contains one point, and every point has a dense orbit. So this is a funny thing. It's a measure which is sitting, yeah? I cannot imagine how this looks like beyond this picture, that it is essentially sitting on pseudo-periodic orbits, something like that. So it's fine. Let's go home. Unless you have a...